Okay. Now, as I was saying when I was so rudely interrupted last week by the bell, the Old Testament, it ends on a note of unfulfilled hope. You see, and I've said this many times, just, I don't know, maybe a month or two ago, I did a sermon on this on Sunday night, but very few of you would have heard it there. But the Old Testament, it ends on a note of unfulfilled hope, and it was clear that in one sense, God had always ruled the world from the time of creation. I mean, there's no question about that. Here are some texts. You see that he was on his heavenly throne, and he reigned over all. So that it's clear that in one sense, God has always ruled the world from the time he made creation. But there's some sense in which his kingly rule was not being fully expressed. He's on the throne, he's ruler of all, but there's some sense in which his kingly rule is not being fully asserted. It's not being fully expressed. He was allowing creation to go on out of step with his ultimate intention for it, to continue in a state of brokenness, to continue in a state of sin and suffering that was contrary to his ultimate vision and purpose. But the prophets, they saw that a day was coming in which God would express his rulership of creation in such a way he would assert his authority over creation in such a way that he would bring everything into harmony and conformity with his ultimate will and purpose. His creation would be redeemed from the dreadful consequences of sin that had invaded it. This world of rebellion, sin, hostility, death, fragmentation would be rescued by God. And it would be transformed into a true utopia, a perfect reality of love, joy, and fellowship with God and one another. See, on that day, God would express or assert his authority over creation in a way he was not doing at present. Not because he's not all authoritative, but because he's tolerating for a time creation going on out of step with his ultimate intention for it. But he won't do that forever. And at that time, you see, he will assert his sovereign power to bring creation to its ultimate fulfillment. And that's what you see when Zechariah, for example, says, see, at that time, he will be king over all the others. Well, he is king. I know that. He's on his throne. But there is a sense in which on that day, when he brings all things into conformity with his ultimate will and purpose, he will be king in a sense he's not now. In a sense that he will assert his kingly authority and rule in a way that he's not doing it at present. Now, the Old Testament, it uses different imagery to refer to that blessed state that God is going to create, the results of his rescue. And the imagery, it varies in how sharply it distinguishes that future blessed state from this present existence, how radically discontinuous it is. It portrays them in different degrees of discontinuity from the present state. But all of the pictures of that state that are given, they say in forms that are relevant to ancient Jews. You see, these are pictures that are relevant to ancient Jews. They say that a time of tremendous divine blessing is coming. It says, these pictures say in forms relevant to ancient Jews, that the failures and sufferings of the present age will be put to rights with the coming of the new age. And so you see this in these things, the restoration of greatness of the coming of a new king like David, God's healing of the world's sicknesses and hatreds, all the way down to a new heaven and a new earth. So these are different pictures that are given. Now, Israel's return to the land, you know, we followed the story of exile. We followed the story of return. all of this picture that's painted, this narrative, this history of Israel is given. And we have this return. But Israel's return to the land after 70 years of exile in Babylonia, that was great. I mean, that was a tremendous exodus, a tremendous exercise of God's power that God had prophesied in advance. But it was still a pale shadow of the kind of glory predicted by the prophets. Israel was small, struggling, and under the oppression of foreign powers, not like the picture we see. They return, that's a great thing, but their return is a pale shadow of the glorious picture that's been painted by the prophets. Ezra, Nehemiah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi, they document the low spiritual state of the nation. They're not in this state yet of where all is working in harmony and in fulfillment of God's ultimate vision, where sin is done away with. No, we see documented that sin is still ravaging the people of Israel after their return from exile. And this continued into the first century, where you see and you know that Israel was weak and poor and was under the rule of pagans, Romans. Right? They're ruling Israel at that time. They're under the domination of a pagan power. It's a weak and a poor nation. So this doesn't square with the glory of the picture of this state that's painted by the prophets. And the people longed for and they prayed for the coming of God, for this final intervention of God. Remember, the whole story has been, we begin with creation, where this very good state that God has created, and then something invades, and it's broken, and it's sick. And the whole narrative of the Bible is God's pursuit of mankind and God's work to heal the sin-sick world. And so God is doing that, and He's at work doing that. And the people in the first century, they're longing for and praying for this final intervention when God would set all things right and He would rule to the fullest extent to the blessing of His people. This is what they want. They're looking for this divine utopia. They're looking for this time when all of this suffering and burden and oppression and sorrow and hatred and sin and death and all of these things will be done away with, and they'll be brought into the full glory of the kingdom of God. This is what they're longing for. This is what they're looking for. And in Mark 15:43, for example, Joseph of Arimathea is described as one who's what? Waiting for the kingdom of God. So here he is, first century Jew. What's he doing? He's waiting for the kingdom of God. Well, what do you mean, waiting for the kingdom of God? He's waiting for God's final intervention to heal the sin-sick world. That's what he wants. That's what he's longing for. And it's at that time that the Lord Jesus came into the world. You see, they're waiting, you know, God, we want this, waiting for the kingdom of God. And here comes Jesus at that time into the world. Now, one cannot understand Jesus' birth without understanding the triune nature of God. As I've said on many occasions, and will say, I'm sure, many other times, but, you know, that Scripture reveals by necessary inference. You see, you can see there are certain things that the way they have to be put together. Scripture reveals by necessary inference that the one being God exists eternally as three co-equal and co-eternal persons: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit. In other words, God exists as one being, one essence or one being, but three distinctive persons. God is a three-person being, not a one-person being. Okay? He's a three-person being, not a one-person being. And this is the doctrine of the Trinity, you see, that was articulated by early Christian theologians. and which has been a test of Christian orthodoxy throughout history. The idea that it is revealed by God that His nature and being is one being, three distinctive persons, a three-person being. Now, that truth is difficult to internalize in part because it's a unique attribute of God. All creatures with which we have any familiarity are one-person beings. Right? One person, one being, that's how they are. But God reveals I'm not like that. I'm a three-person being. And as I've said many times, if they did that on Star Trek, everybody'd say it's cool. If they went to some other planet or something and found, what up? We have a three-person being. Wow, that's mind-blowing, but it's cool. You see? So does it shock us that God is different? God is a three-person being, and because it's outside of our experience, we resort to all kinds of imperfect analogies trying to formulate the truth in terms of our experience. But in a sense, we are like two-dimensional beings trying to understand a three-dimensional being. You see, it's like living in a two-dimensional reality and trying to grasp the concept of a three-dimensional being. People say words to you, but it's like, what do you mean, man? You know, what are you talking about? Well, that's what God is revealing to us. I know that you're into one-person beings. I'm telling you, I'm a three-person being. One being, one essence, three distinctive persons. Now, that's just what's revealed. And as I say, that's been a matter of Christian orthodoxy forever. Now, in the New Testament, there's a brief introduction. Luke gives a brief introduction in his gospel. And then Luke begins with the story of John the Baptist, or John the Baptizer's birth, probably better. But he has a brief introduction, then he begins his story with John the Baptist's birth, followed by the story of Jesus' birth. Matthew begins his gospel with the birth of Jesus. And Mark begins his gospel after John and Jesus are adults. But the Apostle John, he begins his gospel with a reference to eternity. You see, I used to tell people when I was a younger Christian, I'd be sharing with them, I said, man, you know, John, his stuff's cosmic, man. He's like, you know, but John begins his gospel with a reference to eternity. He writes in John 1:1-3, he says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Do you see the sense of distinction and unity? You see, this is it. And he says, He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. And then, lest there be any doubt that the Word he's referring to is the person of the Godhead who became Jesus, is God the Son, he says in verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. So there's no question about who the Word is, who was God. You see, and this is why God is a three-person being. And so you see this, and this is something that's very, very important. And you see, of course, Jesus is expressly called God. All attempts to get around that, to the contrary, notwithstanding. He's called God in these texts. And you see, in fact, in Matthew 1:23, quoting the prophet Isaiah, they shall call His name Emmanuel. And then we get the little statement about, which means God with us. You see, so Jesus here is the incarnation of the second person of the Godhead. God the Son. Now, as I said many weeks ago when we started the story, I don't know how long ago it was, been months, but as I said then, the story of the Bible is the story of God's work through the people of Israel to rescue His creation, which includes mankind, but it's to rescue His creation from its fallen state. People are the high point of God's creation. They're the high point of His creation, but His rescue effort, it involves all of creation. Because all of creation was harmed as a result of sin. That's why the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 8, verses 19 to 22, says that creation itself looks forward to the day when it will be freed from the consequences of human sin. It's like they're with us waiting. So it will be freed, see, no longer subject to decay, the decay to which it was subjected, referring back to the fall. You see, all of creation is involved. It is not as though God starts creation, sin comes and invades it, and God says, okay, you win that round, I scrap it, best 2 out of 3. That's not how it is. It is, I am redeeming my creation. You see, I am redeeming my creation, and that's something that's important. Now, Jesus is the center of this entire effort. It was decided from eternity that to solve the sin problem that would infect the creation, that God the Son, Jesus the Christ, that God the Son would take on himself the penalty. He would become the God-man Jesus. Okay, from eternity to solve the sin problem, it was decided that God the Son, the second person of the Godhead, would become the God-man Jesus, who is the Christ. He would become the God-man Jesus, and he would take on himself the penalty that all human sin deserved. He would do that. This allows, see, this isn't just a thing. It's important to see because it allows God to forgive sin without making light of the horror of sin, without winking at it, without trivializing it. It allows God to forgive in a way that's consistent with his nature, a way that it expresses his love without neglecting his holiness and justice. You see, God is perfectly holy, perfectly pure, perfectly just, but he's also perfectly loving. So our sin creates something of tension. How is God going to honor his love while maintaining his holiness and justice and still forgive us? How can that be worked out? Well, he takes on himself the punishment that our sin deserves so he can forgive righteously. He can forgive justly. He can forgive in a way that does not trivialize the ultimate, absolute horror that sin is. That's why we have such a problem with it. We do not in our gut, because we are down here in the trash, living this way, sin does not strike us as that big a deal. It simply does not. And that's part of why we have trouble. How can anything merit eternal punishment? Well, there are a number of ways of looking at it. One of Thomas Aquinas' ideas, he said, look, do you know that in society, now this doesn't hold for American society, see, that's part of why, part of our difficulty. But he said, you realize an offense committed against a person escalates depending on the glory of the person against whom it's committed. For instance, if you strike a servant or something like that, that's one thing. You strike somebody who's here, that's another thing. You strike a governor, that's one thing. You strike the king, oh my. You see, oh my. Well, you strike the absolutely perfect, atomic, white, holy, pure God. And what's the just penalty for that? Okay, so that's this idea, you see, that... But anyway, Jesus takes on flesh. But it's important beyond that, you see, because it allows this idea, and that's why it's so important. When Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes to the Father but through me, because there is no other avenue of forgiveness that honors God's righteousness and his holiness. It is because in Christ, he himself took the punishment. So you want to be forgiven outside of that. No. That is the way. And so it's just something that's very important. Now, in eternity, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, they freely chose the roles that they would take in the work of redemption. I always get a kick out of people saying, well, this was child abuse to do this with Jesus. As though God the Son's not part of this. That somehow we're, you know, God the Father is doing this to the Son. as though the son, as though they're not all in sync and that this was what they were doing. Let me read to you. I've read this before. It's a little quote from James White that I like. It says, the Father chose to be the fountain source of the entirety of the work. The Son chose to be the Redeemer and to enter into human flesh as one subject to the Father. And the Spirit chose to be the sanctifier of the church, the indwelling testifier of Jesus Christ. From eternity, the roles were there on what they were going to do, each person of the one being God, how they were going to function in the work of redemption from the sin that they foresaw was going to come in. And so they each took this role, and this is what we have in the birth of Christ. All right, now let's talk about the birth. Matthew 1, 18 and 19. This is how the birth of Jesus came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, before they had sex, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. Mary and Joseph were betrothed, which, as you may know, in ancient Judaism, this was really the first part of the marriage process. It's a much stronger relationship than what we call being engaged. It was such a binding arrangement. This betrothal was such a binding arrangement that the parties were considered husband and wife. The woman was considered a widow if her husband died during the time of betrothal. And the relationship could only be broken by a divorce. So it's not the same as our engagement. It's really the first stage of marriage, a much stronger relationship. And after betrothal, the woman typically would continue living with her parents for about a year. And then the husband would bring her to his house where the marriage was finalized in a ceremony. Now, verses 18 and 19 of Matthew chapter 1, they take place during this interim period when Joseph and Mary were betrothed, but not yet finally married. So it's in this interim period, and you can imagine the problem when it became apparent to Joseph and others that his betrothed was pregnant. Right? I mean, you can imagine that. The problem that caused, since Joseph knows he's not slept with her. You know, he knows that is a fact. He knows that. Well, then he naturally figures that she's committed adultery. Who wouldn't think that? Well, that's what he thinks. And so does everybody else. That she's committed adultery, meaning she has broken that stronger thing, that betrothal. And she's committed adultery. Of course, the truth is that Mary had become pregnant by the miraculous operation of the Holy Spirit. I love when you say that to people, and they go, pfft. And I just say, oh, so God couldn't do that. He couldn't do that. He speak this whole thing into existence, but that's what you got. You stumped him on that one. He said, I can create anything. I'm all powerful. But man, I haven't figured out how to do that yet. All right, this is what happens. God miraculously, the Spirit miraculously impregnates Mary. And so that's the real story there. She hasn't committed adultery. Now, God, the Spirit, placed within this virgin's womb the God-human, Jesus. Now, it doesn't get any more mind-blowing than this. Okay, this to me, this is about tops it. That in this virgin, the Holy Spirit places the God-man. Man. You see? That's what happens. The God-man is there. Now, Joseph apparently wasn't convinced that Mary's impregnation was miraculous, assuming she had told him. We're not told that, but if she comes and said, listen, no, I wasn't unfaithful. The Holy Spirit did this. If she told him that, he's apparently not buying it because he was a righteous man, meaning he was pious or law-abiding. He determined he wasn't going to marry an adulteress. He thought that wasn't appropriate, that wasn't proper, that wasn't righteous. Because he was a righteous man, a law-abiding, pious man, he had figured out and decided that he was not going to marry an adulteress, but he had no desire to be harsh with Mary. No desire. So rather than divorce her by way of a public trial, which would have meant her abject humiliation, right? I mean, if I'm putting her stuff in the streets, and I'm sitting there going, look, she's betrothed to me, now look at her. She's been out, you know, sleeping around. Well, he didn't want to do that. He had no desire to be that way with her. He had in mind, rather, he was going to divorce her privately, meaning he was going to give her a bill of divorce signed by a couple of witnesses. No big deal, and just, you know, we're through, but go ahead. So that's what that's talking about. And you get him in verses 20 and 21. It says, but after he'd considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Now, after considering, he's got this idea he's going to divorce Mary quietly. Well, he's visited in a dream by an angel of the Lord. Apparently, when this happens, there's no question about it. This is an angel of the Lord appearing to me. And so he's visited by this angel, and the angel tells Joseph that he's not to worry that by taking Mary home that he would be marrying an adulteress, something that he feels like can't do in good conscience. You don't worry about that, you see. She's not an adulteress. This isn't the situation where she's given herself to some man. Rather, she's been given a child miraculously through the Holy Spirit. She's a one of a kind. In all of history, all the time, she's a one of a kind, that she has been impregnated miraculously by the Holy Spirit. She is carrying the God-man. Okay, so he's told this, and he's reassured about this. And that Joseph's told that the child Mary's carrying, he's told that the child is a boy, and that he is to give the child the name Jesus. And this is important, because by naming the child, Joseph officially accepted the child and made him his son. You see, this is what this is about. By naming him, Joseph brought Jesus into his lineage, though he was not the biological father. There is no biological father in terms of men. There's only God. But Joseph names him, and he becomes Joseph's son. That is who he is. He's called the carpenter's son. He's called the son of Joseph. He is the son of Joseph. Is that all there is to say about that? No, that's not all there is to say about it. But he is the son of Joseph, because he was named by Joseph, and we have a virgin conception. And then Joseph names him, so he is the earthly father of Joseph. How else do you work these things when you have something as far out as, you know, the God-man and a virginal conception? So this is important. He names him. Now, Joseph is, of course, a descendant of David. That's specified in the genealogy in Matthew chapter 1. And he's called son of David by the angel in Matthew 1:20. He's called the son of David there, and he's identified as a descendant of David in Luke 1:27 and Luke chapter 2, verse 4. So he's clearly in the lineage of David. So whatever link Jesus may have to David through Mary, and that's debatable about what link he has to David through Mary, whatever link Jesus has to David through Mary, he's linked to David legally as Joseph's son. That's why you keep seeing the references to Joseph, son of David. He's linked to David legally as Joseph's son. Now, that's important, right? Because God had promised King David 1,000 years earlier that one of his descendants would sit on his throne forever. 2 Samuel chapter 7, Psalm 89. That your throne is going to be one that's going to last. It's not going to be like Saul. Your dynasty is not going to be taken. A descendant of yours is going to be on the throne. You see, so this is very important. Now, as you probably know, the genealogies in Matthew 1 and Luke 3 are quite different. And this has caused no amount of head scratching. But the genealogies are quite different. There, you know, one of them goes, in Matthew, it goes from Abraham down to Joseph. In Luke, it descends in Matthew. In Luke, it ascends from Joseph all the way back to Adam. Okay, so there's those kinds of differences, but there are also differences in the people who are identified in the lineages. Now, there are a number of possible ways to understand those differences in keeping with the inerrancy of Scripture. If you haven't figured by now, I believe in the inerrancy of Scripture. I believe that God breathed Scripture, and being perfect and all-knowing, Scripture affirms nothing that is contrary to fact. Okay? One must work to understand what is Scripture affirming. There are all kinds of phrases, and there are all kinds of, you know, symbolism, and, you know, there are figures of speech. I understand that. But when one rightly discerns what Scripture is affirming, one can be certain that it's not contrary to fact. Okay, that's what I mean by inerrancy. So there are a number of ways of understanding these differences that in keeping with inerrancy, but opinions are divided on which is the best way to go about it. In other words, there's no clear way to do it. You see, there are little things that don't quite fit with any path you take. They're possible, you see. There are a number of possible ways, but there's nothing that it resonates so everybody goes, ah, there you go, you see. And so there are a number of possible ways. Some think that Luke gives Mary's genealogy, with Joseph being named in place of Mary, because it's postulated that Mary's father had no sons and he adopted Joseph as his son-in-law, so then he becomes the legal heir. And in that case, Jesus linked to David would then be through both Joseph and Mary. Okay, that's possible. A number of people shy away from that because it certainly seems like a genealogy of Joseph. Okay, but another possibility is that both genealogies refer to Joseph, but Matthew gives the genealogy of throne succession, of kingly succession, whereas Luke gives the genealogy of physical descent. Now those lines meet. Throne succession and physical descent, they meet in Joseph through a postulated levirate marriage. You see, where you could have Mathan, his widow, they have Joseph, or Jacob, and then he dies, the widow marries Mathat, they have Heli, making Heli and Jacob half-brothers. Jacob has no heirs, he dies, there's a levirate marriage. And so then you have Heli being the physical, biological father of Joseph, and the legal descent in a levirate marriage continues through that side. Okay, that's one possible way. There are other ways. There have been, you know, half a dozen ways that this has been, you know, some people would say over here we have the other way. All I wanted to say, without going into, you know, a lot of the details, I just wanted you to note that there are various possible ways to skin that cat. Okay, so when some, you know, this is the kind of thing people say, you see, these things are hopelessly contradictory. People panic. It's not. There are various ways to skin that cat, but I did want you to be aware that none of the ways is obvious, and none of the ways is problem-free. But a number of ways are possible. You see, and that's just how things work out. All right, the angel tells Joseph that he's to name the child Jesus. He says, because he will save his people from their sins. Now, that strikes us as odd. At least it ought to. I mean, you're to name him Jesus because he'll save his people from their sins. But it sounds strange until you understand that the English name Jesus is a transliteration by way of Latin. You know what transliteration is, right? Where we're not translating something. We're just trying to find how do you spell it in our language. You see, how do you do it in our script? Like, you know, with baptizo in Greek, and they just decided we just transliterate the word and make up a word, baptize, okay, which has now come into the English language. But that's what transliterating is, okay? So when you understand that the English name Jesus is simply a transliteration by way of Latin of the Greek name, Iesus, which was itself a transliteration of the Hebrew name Yeshua. Okay, so Yeshua in Hebrew transliterates into Greek as Jesus. Now, it's interesting, when we translate Yeshua in Hebrew, we translate it Joshua. But once it's transliterated into Greek, we call it Jesus. But it's the same root name. You see, it's the same root name. And that's important because the Hebrew name Yeshua means Yahweh, God is salvation. Okay, so he says you're to name him Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. You are to name him God is salvation because he will save his people from their sins. So the angel reveals, you see, the essence of the incarnation. The essence of the incarnation, the person, the purpose for which the Son of God took on human flesh. You're to name him Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. He entered this world to save his people from their sins. And as Jesus himself said in Luke 19:10, the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost. Why did God the Son, the second person of the Godhead, come into this world as part of this larger redemption effort as the man Jesus, the God-man? Why did he do it? You're to name him Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. That's why he did it. That's why he did it. Everybody who's old enough and everyone who's sane enough to be morally responsible has sinned. Do I even have to say that to you? If you don't have that degree of introspection to realize that that's true, that everyone who is old enough and sane enough to be morally responsible has sinned. Paul says in Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And everyone who has sinned is in need of saving, is in need of rescue. We're in a dire situation. And so you're to name him Jesus because you are to name him God is salvation because he will save his people from their sins. Well, Joseph takes Mary. You're familiar with the story, I trust. Joseph takes Mary home to be his wife, but he has no sexual relations with her. You can see that in Matthew 1:24 and 25. And then he and his pregnant wife, they travel from Nazareth down to Bethlehem. It's something like, 60-some miles as the crow flies, but maybe 80 miles to have to walk or more. But they make this journey. She's pregnant. They come down from Nazareth. They come down to Bethlehem. And he and the pregnant Mary make this journey. And that's the prophesied birthplace of Jesus. Well, how about that? Micah chapter 5, verse 2. Where's the Messiah going to be born? Well, he's going to be born in Bethlehem. Well, what do you know? They're up here in Nazareth. Well, make the journey down to Bethlehem, the prophesied birthplace of the Messiah. And as a descendant of David, you see, they're going. Why are they going there? You know why they're going. They're going there because there's been a Roman census. The Romans, who are, they're like all governments. They have an insatiable appetite for tax money. And so they're going here. They're saying, okay, we want to get a head count. So what you're going to do is you're going to go to your hometown. Bethlehem is David's, King David's hometown. Joseph is a descendant of David, so he needs to go to Bethlehem to be registered for this census. That's what brings him to Bethlehem. Do you see God? Do you see him working? Isn't that something? Prophesy in advance, where is he going to be born? Bethlehem. Well, he's up in Nazareth. Don't worry about it. What's happening? Well, I think we need a census. Oh, what does that require? Travel to Bethlehem. How about that? So this is what's going on. They wind up doing that. As a descendant of David, Joseph's compelled to go there for the census. And Jesus is, of course, born there. Some 6 months earlier, Mary's older relative, Elizabeth, gave birth to John the Baptizer. And so they go down there. Jesus is born in Bethlehem. And also this thing about there's no room for the inn, no room for them at the inn. It probably means guest room, okay? No room for them in the guest room. Of the ancestral family place, so they stayed back in the portion that was where people would lock their animals up, you see, because you didn't want to leave your asset floating around in the dark out there. because I know it's hard to believe, someone might steal it. And so they would bring them in at night and lock them back in the back portion of the house. And so this is where they wind up being. But that word's used two other times in the New Testament. You see there it means guest room or guest place in the house. Now the shepherds, they arrive soon after the birth. The eighth day after his birth, Jesus is circumcised. That's when he's formally given the name Jesus. And 40 plus days after his birth, Joseph and Mary, they take Jesus up to the temple in compliance with the law of Moses. And there they offer the sacrifice of two doves or pigeons, which signified they were poor. All of this in keeping with the law. They return to Bethlehem. And you have to look at, you have to look at Matthew and Luke. It's easy to get moved there. But they return, after that, they return to Bethlehem. And perhaps near the end of Jesus' first year. Not like we typically see in these scenes of, the wise men there and all that. It's near the end of the first year. That the Magi, they call Magi, and they're sometimes, we three kings, they're not kings. They're like astrologers, and they're from the East, and they may be from Persia. And you say, well, how would they tune into this? Well, let me think. Daniel's over there. A lot of people over there. A lot of Jewish roots and history over there. So it doesn't say they're from Persia, but it says from the East. And so, but here they come, and you know the story. But that's probably a year into Jesus' life. That they wind up, they see the star, they make plans, they make the journey, they go to Herod. Herod says, oh yeah, I'm into it, go find him. They go down there, and they find him with this miraculous star guiding them. And then when they don't come back, because they realize that Herod is a rat, and so they say, we're not going to go back that way. And when Herod dawns on him finally that, look, these guys aren't coming back to tell me where this child is so I can kill my rival. And I think there's an interesting section, by the way, in Revelation chapter 12. Where, crouching, Satan crouching, or the dragon, whatever it is, before the birth, the woman having the child, ready to kill it, you see? But anyway, so he goes down there. What's he do? You know what he does. He kills all the children in the region who are 2 years old and under. Why? He gives himself margin of error. Okay, he kills all the... But before that happened, an angel had appeared to Joseph. See, this is like he's being cared for. Angel says, you got to get out. So they go to Egypt. Herod dies, probably in 4 B.C., although, as I said before, some would put it earlier or later. Probably in 4 B.C., and the angel says, okay, go back. And they go back, and this time they go back to Nazareth, and that's the place where they had lived before they left to go to Bethlehem for the census. They go back to Nazareth. And this is probably 3 B.C. Herod dies in 4, so Jesus is just a toddler. When they go back to Nazareth. And then we see in Luke 2:40, it says, and the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. And then the next verse, Luke 2:41, jumps to the story when he's 12 years old. You remember? He's in the temple. Family leaves. Family's got to come back. Then he accompanies them back. And you get this line here in Luke 2:51 and 52, and he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was submissive to them. And his mother treasured up all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. He is the God-man. He's truly man. He's also truly God. You see, God-man, divine nature, human nature, together in one person. Not mixed into something different. Divine nature, human nature, one person. Let me say one word about Mary. Okay, I had here, I wanted to emphasize Christ's deity. He doesn't lose his deity when he becomes the God-man. He is God. Okay, he is God. But let me just say quickly about Mary. I think because we are in reaction to Catholicism's exaltation of Mary, I think we tend to ignore or not give Mary, we don't esteem her the way I think she should be esteemed. That is our tendency in an overreaction to her exaltation by Roman Catholicism. Okay, she is the Lord's mother. And I'm telling you, I'm sure the Lord is very fond of his mother. Amen. She nursed him, taught him, all of that. So she is somebody who's worthy of being esteemed. Not worshipped, but esteemed. You see, Luke 1:28, greetings, you are highly favored. Angel says to Mary, Spirit said to Mary through Elizabeth, blessed are you among women. Luke 1, 48-49, Mary exclaims, "From now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me." You see, she was a faithful instrument of God's work, and you and I honor faithful instruments of God's work, right? We don't shy away from honoring. You go, "Uh-oh, somebody's gotten off track on it, so I better not pay any attention to this person or give them any honor." She's due honor. She's a very faithful servant, and she was the physical person who brought the Lord Jesus into this world. The God-man. Okay, over time, thank you.